Chegamos ao nosso dia derradeiro da feira e fórum. A feira acabou ontem, hoje é o dia do último dia do fórum de internacionalização. Vamos ter uma fala de um convidado que já parece íntimo de muitos anos, já esteve com a gente desde ontem. Nós gravamos um programa na UNBTV e, no início da tarde, ele proferiu uma palestra apresentando o U Multirank. Estou falando do professor Dr. Frank Ziegele. Ele é diretor executivo do Centro de Educação Superior Gütersloh, um think tank alemão para políticas e gestão de ensino superior, professor de ensino superior e gestão de pesquisa na Universidade de Ciências Aplicadas de Osnabrück, economista de formação. Sua pesquisa e publicações se concentram em finanças, governança, políticas, gestão estratégica, gerenciamento de contratos, classificação e contabilidade. Nessas áreas, também atua como consultor, instrutor e palestrante em todo o mundo. Contribuiu com mais de 150 publicações para o domínio da política e gestão de ensino superior e realizou cerca de 100 projetos nacionais e internacionais no mesmo domínio. É editor de várias revistas. E hoje ele falará sobre o desafio de enfrentarmos questões e problemas mundiais que são cada vez mais interdisciplinares, com as nossas universidades departamentalizadas e divididas em quadradinhos nos quais a gente não sabe o que o vizinho está fazendo e como fazer para desconstruir essa realidade. A palestra vai ser traduzida. Quem precisar de acompanhamento em português, é só usar o código que está descrito no aplicativo da Microsoft Translator. Dr. Ziegele, please.
Here it is. So, good morning, everybody. Welcome to my second appearance here in this forum. I see some faces again that I already saw yesterday, so welcome back. Some new faces as well, so welcome now for the first time. Yesterday, like Virgilio was saying in his kind introduction, I was talking about new rankings, multi-dimensional ranking systems, such as U Multirank. Today, completely different topic, but not less important. And you see it here from the headline of my speech, how to overcome faculty borders and make universities more interdisciplinary. Experiences from Europe. So I would like to tell you what we are doing in Germany and in the surrounding countries in order to come closer to this important objective that I think is also quite relevant in your country. So let me start by saying, well, why do we urgently need more interdisciplinarity in teaching and learning and also in research? I think it's quite obvious, you will all know the arguments. The first one is, if we as universities want to answer to global challenges, we only can do it if we bring together different disciplines. There is no discipline which can find an answer to the issues of climate change, to the issues of all the other things that we are working on. So we need contributions from many disciplines. Second, scientific progress often happens by linking different disciplinary approaches. Yeah, a couple of years ago, we didn't talk about biochemistry. Today, of course, we take it for granted that biology and chemistry together give enormous insights into what we want to understand about the world. So scientific process by linking disciplines. Borders of disciplines are continuously dynamic, so they shift. Yeah, disciplines merge, disciplines split from others. So there is a continuous dynamics behind it. And so this is more an argument related to the students and the programs that we do at universities. Labor markets, of course, on the one hand, want specialists, but they also want people with a more generalist view. So there is a good reason to have programs, I come back to that later on, to have study programs which are quite special, but there's also good reason to have some which go more into a general outlook. So you will find now in universities programs on life sciences, yeah, which is a broad concept which includes different disciplines but leads to a more generalist approach. But you see here, that's not the one and only thing. It's one tendency. The other is, of course, you still need specialists. Just very brief, what is interdisciplinarity? I put it in brackets here in the end. There are people who will be able to discuss for hours what the slight difference between multidisciplinarity, interdisciplinarity, and transdisciplinarity is. I won't do this here. I want to be more practical, so not so much talking about theoretical concepts. I just want to say I understand about it. There are two or more disciplines involved. I think it's quite clear. They tackle the same questions, but they use different paradigms. Yeah, they look at the world from different points of view. There is parallel play in research, for instance, but there is high interaction. Yeah, if it's just parallel, one is doing his stuff and the other is also doing it and they do not relate, then it's not really interdisciplinarity. Yeah? So you need the relations. The methods could also synthesize. So in the end, a new discipline might emerge. There might be separate publications and outcomes or also shared ones, and there will be joint products of the different disciplines. So that's the idea of being interdisciplinary. Now, what's the problem? I tried to find a picture which, to a certain extent, might show what our problem at universities is. I would be curious if you would confirm this for your universities. If we look at our faculties, yeah, faculties are working in silos. So they are sitting in their small thing. Yeah, maybe if you're lucky, you know the professor next door, yeah, and then you work together. Maybe, yeah, and you work together in your group of friends where you know everyone. But where is the link between these silos? So our organizational structures are against interdisciplinarity. They do not promote it, and that's a very difficult starting point. On the other hand, yeah, I would not try to argue that we don't need faculties. You could say, well, if these silos don't make sense, just turn them down and establish something new. Of course, first of all, you can only achieve some depth in theoretical and methodological knowledge if you are in a certain discipline. Yeah, you cannot just do everything. You need a lot of methodology. So you can only start to cross borders if there is a border to a certain extent. So it's quite natural that this exists. And we will all know this feeling. Academics need a kind of homeland with people of their kind. Yeah, you need these people who, I come back to that later on, who speak the same language than you. And we all know that different disciplines speak very different languages. So you have to feel at home. You need a home base. And that's the faculty. Yeah, so that's why a faculty is so important for the identity of people. So you need it. And you are only prepared to deal with something different if you know your own identity. Yeah, so the tricky thing about promoting interdisciplinarity, and this is an important task for higher education management, we need university structures and processes that on the one hand protect your home base, so your disciplinary homeland, and on the other hand, stimulate interdisciplinary collaboration. So you need both, and that's the task for higher education management, to find that balance. So I try to find another picture which maybe expresses that, that you see there are still silos, yeah, but they are a bit more colorful on the one hand, and on the other hand, there are links, yeah, so they are somehow related. Don't know if this is a perfect picture for it, but I try, yeah, so it's different from the first one that you saw. Yeah, so this is what we need. And now the big question is, how can we get there? And looking at all the experience I found in my country, in neighboring countries, I had the idea that I should create this kind of small model. And what I want to do with you within the next minutes is to dig deeper into the different parts of this diagram. So you will see this diagram again and again in the following minutes, because I want to tackle these different things. So first of all, interdisciplinarity needs a certain organization of research. It also needs a certain organization of how you do teaching and learning. This will work if you have a good structural framework, and the components I want to show you regarding the structural framework is organizational structure, internal communication, incentive systems, and transfer systems. So these are the four aspects of what I would like to see as a good structural framework for interdisciplinary collaboration. And all this, of course, is influenced by the university strategy, which also could help to be more interdisciplinary. And I would like to start with the university strategy. And now you will see for each of these components, I would like to show you some examples, what's happening, and then we can have a discussion in the end about that. So what happens in terms of university strategy? If I look at the universities in my country, in Germany, I will find that a lot of them now these days focus their strategy on topics. Yeah, they say, we solve the problems of traffic, or we solve the problems of whatever. So the strategy is focused on a specific topic. And there are two potential ways to do that. The first, I would say this is a resource-based view. It's the bundling of the internal strengths to focus on a cross-cutting topic. Yeah, so you look into your university, you see what the faculties are doing, and you identify there is a cross-cutting thing where they could work together. And then you push it by strategic development. That's the first possibility. It means setting priorities. I know some universities, for instance, who do it in the following way. They set priorities. They say there are five topics which are in our focus. And if a professor retires and the position of a professor is free, for every professor it is checked, is the professorship in the future within the topic or outside the topic? If it's outside the topic, the rector takes away the professorship and puts it somewhere else. Yeah, so this is a strategic priority that universities are setting. Second, market-based view, you address external needs. So you look for the grand challenges or the social development goals. I will show you an example in a second of a university doing that. So it's not only your own resources, it's also what the market wants and the market demands. And it is the focus on what we in our country usually call third mission. You can also call it community service. I think it's also called extension. Yeah, so there are different words for that. So the relations to society, the regional engagement, solving local problems. This, of course, is also something, if you focus on that in your strategy, it is required that you bring together the disciplines, because also this regional engagement could only work on that basis. Yeah. So now let's look for some examples. I took the University College London. So that's not a German example, that's an example from the UK. But the University College says, our strategy focuses on six grand challenges. Yeah, this is what we want to do. We want to do something for global health, sustainable cities, cultural understanding, human well-being, justice and equality, and transformative technology. So that's the focus. Yeah, and now everything we do is promoting these areas of interest, and we need different disciplines. In all of these you will need different disciplines, like you can see here in this wild diagram, because all these relationships here, so here you see the different subjects, health science, medical, life, brain, etc. And here you see the cross-disciplinary relationships in research collaboration. So each of these lines stands for a research collaboration around these global challenges. Yeah, so you see the colors relate to the colors you see here. Yeah, so well, nobody can understand that picture, of course, but yeah, it shows how intensive the relations between the disciplines evolved in that university around these grand challenges. So an interesting example. Second example, that's a medium-sized regional university from my country in Wuppertal. You might not know that. And what did they do? They said, we have teaching and research profiles according to our internal strengths. So this is the resource-based view that I mentioned in my first chart. And here are the topics. So they focus on building blocks of meta and simulation, education and knowledge in social and cultural context, health, illness, and so on, language, narration and editing, natural environment, energy and safety, innovation and economic change. Well, some of them seem to be a bit broad and vague, yeah, but so this is not so much looking at social development goals or something like that. This is looking inside the university and trying to identify what are we good at. And now we, as a strategic approach, we will approach these aspects in our internal priority setting. So another example. And that's it. So just I wanted to show you these two examples, and you could find many, many more. And you could also find, of course, things in your country, even here at the university. What was the name? The institutional development program. Yeah, so I think this is the first step into something like this strategic approach. Okay, second part. So now I would like to go to the structural framework. Organizational structure. What can you do in terms of organizational structure in order to overcome faculty borders? Of course, what you have to do is you have to create horizontal structures between faculties. Yeah, so you have a vertical structure and you need something horizontal as well, which makes people work together. And you see here, so these are different forms of cross-cutting horizontal structures. And going up here, these components become stronger. So the matrix is the strongest, the network is the weakest. So what is a network? It means, well, we have different faculties, but we organize meeting, workshops, some kind of interaction. Yeah, so I come back to that when I talk about communication. So we bring people together. Yeah. Then we could say there might be cross-cutting processes, joint planning processes, or joint standards between faculties. Again, stronger is you form teams, you establish task forces, project groups, so there are some formal elements and you identify a specific goal, so you set up groups of researchers from different faculties. You nominate a coordinator, so there is an institutionalized structure for coordination which has no formal decision rights, but which tries to promote. You know, so that would be, I don't know, in your university structure, that might be a dean for internal cooperation or something like that, yeah, who has the task to promote the whole thing as a coordinator. And the strongest one would be a real matrix. That means there is leadership also in the cross-cutting dimension. I will show you an example in a second, then you will understand what I mean by a matrix. So there are real organizational units for the horizontal aspect. So I will show you a strong matrix structure in a minute. So the complexity and the costs of the cross-cutting structures is increasing, but the cross-cutting structures become stronger if you go up here. So if you only have a team, yeah, if you have a coordinator, it's a bit stronger. If you have a real matrix, it becomes even stronger. And here is the example of a real matrix structure. And from my perspective, this is a very extreme example. We don't have it in Germany. It exists in some Dutch universities. And you might raise some doubts if this is really a good idea. We can discuss that later on, so I also have some doubts about that. But it's an interesting structure. So this Dutch university, I think there are three or four of them who use that kind of structure, has two kinds of units. So they have basic units, which is the classical homeland of a researcher. Yeah, so this is, you could call it an institute or a department or something like that. So this is really the people sitting together in the same discipline doing the same things. Yeah, so groups of 10, 15 people or so who really are together in a certain discipline. And so that's one side of the matrix. The other side of the matrix is research centers and study programs. So this university established, according to the topics they want to do research on, research centers. And there is a leader of the research center. Yeah, there is a director of the basic unit, but there is also a leader of the research center. And we have every study program here, and there is also a leader of the study program. And now what's the funding model of that university? The rectorate of the university distributes the money to the study programs and to the research centers, not to the basic units. Yeah, so the decision on what money is spent for is made by these managers of research units and study programs. And what are they doing? They are buying people on an internal labor market. So you see what's going on here? So these basic units have to see that the people in these units have something to do. Yeah, because if they wouldn't be bought on the internal labor market, the basic unit would have a problem because they have to pay the salaries. Yeah, so they pay the salaries, but they have to earn the money by selling their people to the internal programs and research units. Isn't that a bit crazy? On the one hand, it's crazy, but on the other hand, it's a real matrix, yeah, because these people buy people from all kinds of faculties. Yeah, so this is a very, very clear model to overcome faculty structures, because the faculty doesn't decide on the study program. Yeah, the faculty doesn't decide on the research topic. So this is really done in this kind of matrix. Is that clear? Yeah, so very interesting structure, but also with some shortcomings. And it's a very tough structure. Yeah, it's I think you also have your federal universities have a lot of or only civil servants. Yeah, how can you do something like that with civil servants? Because you would, if here is someone that you cannot sell on your internal labor market, maybe you have to get rid of that person. Yeah, and how can you get rid of the person if he or she is a civil servant? Yeah, so the question is, can you apply it? But I think it's an interesting experiment to do it like that. I also know some universities who gave that up again because they said it's too complicated. But that's another thing. Yeah, so you see, that's the idea of cross-cutting structures overcoming faculty borders, because faculty borders do not play a role in this. They always try to find the best people from all faculties. So that's a strong structure. A weaker structure, that's a German university, University in Erlangen-Nürnberg. For instance, they established an organizational unit called Interdisciplinary Center for Public Health. Yeah, so this is just an example. So the center has an own governance structure. It has members, it has goals. It involves faculties such as medicine, philosophy, theology, engineering, and economics. It's doing research, consultancy, policy advice, and it's the contact point for the stakeholders. Yeah, so this just, they establish a prominent institute for a certain topic, and they create a kind of structure around it. Yeah, so professors are on the one hand member of a faculty, but on the other hand member of the Interdisciplinary Center for Public Health. So it's a kind of double membership and a kind of dual structure. So that also goes in the direction of Matrix, but is weaker than the first one. Or a third one, so this is an example, I showed you here this coordinator approach. So this is an example for an institutional coordinator, the Technical University in Darmstadt. They have a forum on interdisciplinary research, which is responsible for the whole coordination task all over the university. So that's a central platform for the whole university. They have a director and fellows who are nominated for 2 to 3 years. So you're not a permanent member, but you're a fellow for a certain time. There's an administration. They do agenda setting by promoting topics. So they have a strategic task as well, of course, which has to be coordinated with the rectorate. So they move forward with strategy. So their topics at the moment are digitalization, water, creativity, humans and machines, just as examples for what they focus on. And their tasks and formats are workshops, conferences, meetings. The university has a yearly day of interdisciplinarity. So this is kind of, they try to mobilize people for interdisciplinary research and teaching by celebrating it in a specific day where everyone comes together, important speeches are given, and so on. They have a small internal competitive fund. So if they come up by saying we want to promote interdisciplinary projects in digitalization, then they could also say we have a certain sum of money where we can support your project. So they also provide funding, and they provide services for these bottom-up initiatives. Yeah, so it's a kind of bottom-up, top-down thing. On the one hand, they try to coordinate, they have some money, they try to set topics, but they also look for the bottom-up initiatives coming up and try to help and promote them. Yeah, so that's this coordination thing. So these were three examples about organizational structures. Let's move on quite quickly to internal communication. I already mentioned that in some respect, but maybe just a few more examples. Yeah, so many universities, of course, now are having workshops, brown bag lunches, retreats, whatever. So opportunities where researchers from different faculties can come together. An interesting one is the Technical University of Dresden. They employed, I think it's 3 or 4 people, and they work as, they call it, research scouts. So these people look at what the researchers are doing. It's a very large university. So they identify joint interests. So these are young people. Yeah, they are running around in the university all day, talking to researchers, trying to find out what's happening, and they bring people together. Yeah, they are facilitators of collaboration. And so I recently talked to the rector, and he said, well, this is quite successful. Yeah, so these people are really able to mobilize. And if you suddenly see, there is a guy in our neighboring faculty, and he's doing quite the same thing from a different perspective, yeah, usually you don't know that. But with the scouts, you will find them. And I think that's an interesting thing. And I think that's also, I recently also talked to a rector about that. Many universities now have informal meetings of all newly appointed professors in a certain year, for instance, and including the president or the rector of a university. And people say that in these meetings, sometimes this is really already the kickoff for a great interdisciplinary collaboration. Yeah, so because these young people, yeah, they are still in a phase of orientation, they don't know everyone, and they are very open to the ideas of others. So bringing together researchers and teachers in a very early phase might also be an interesting idea. So this is also applied quite successfully. And you might have other examples from your contexts where you try just, yeah, make people communicate, bring people together. That's the basic idea about this part of the story. So that's it with internal communication. A few words about incentive systems. Of course, you're lucky if you if you cannot only try to argue that this is good and do scouting and so on, but if you also have some money to promote it, of course, that's a good opportunity. So you could, so some universities have funding pools for interdisciplinary research projects with different target groups. Some have it for PhD candidates, for instance. I will show you in a second what that means, internal competition to become a unit of priority. You could go more to team rewards instead of individual incentives. This is a very special thing. In many of our universities, you might also have that. We have funding of the faculties according to the number of students. Yeah, so money is distributed according to the number of students. And if you have a student which receives teaching from different faculties, the student gets a higher weight in the formula of funding, for instance. Yeah, that's just a very specific example, but I just want to say with that example, there are ways to incentivize collaboration in that way. Or what we do in almost all universities now in our country, when professors are appointed, they sign target agreements with the rector. And target agreements are defining the goals for the next 5 years that the person wants to follow. And there could, of course, also be the obligation to contribute to cross-cutting topics. So also that would be an incentive system promoting it. And then the rector would say, well, you will get a certain amount of money to do it, but we will check if you really contributed to the cross-cutting topic in the end. So incentive systems. And I said here this internal competition. Here we have an example that's Siegen University. They created, they call it a kind of internal research excellence competition. So University of Siegen is a university which knows very, very clearly that they cannot be excellent in research in all subjects and all fields. They are a small university, they have to focus. Yeah, if they really want to do top research, they have to focus. So what did they do? They created throughout the whole university 2 to 3 profile areas. They are identified and they are communicated as centers of excellence. And at the same time, they identify not only profile areas, but also potential areas. And the message here is, this is an area which is not research excellent yet, but has the chance to get there. Yeah, and all these areas are interdisciplinary again. And now they set up a kind of internal competition because they say, well, all of these areas are periodically assessed with a kind of quality assessment, peer review is taking place. And the profile areas, if they do not succeed, they could fall out. Yeah, so they could not be funded anymore as profile areas, but the potential areas might move up to profile areas. Yeah, so you see that's a kind of hierarchy of interdisciplinary areas, and it's a kind of permanent internal competition that they start. So new potential areas could come in. So that's the way how they try to do it and incentivize it. Transfer, very briefly, a bi-directional transfer approach could also promote interdisciplinarity by asking for solutions. What do I mean by that? Knowledge transfer by universities is often seen in a one-directional way. We produce knowledge at the university and we transfer it to society. A modern approach of knowledge transfer says it's a bi-directional thing. So society gives us something back. Society gives inputs to our research agenda. Again, Siegen University, they say we transfer knowledge, but our partners in society give us input to research, for instance, about priority areas of research. So this bi-directional thing is also able to promote interdisciplinarity. There's an interesting approach in the Netherlands. They have a system they call knowledge vouchers. Knowledge voucher is a funding system of the government for small and medium enterprises. And if the small and medium enterprise sets up a project with a university, the company can go to the ministry and can say, hey, we work with this university, please give us a knowledge voucher to fund the contribution of the university. Yeah, so the money goes to the university, but the small and medium enterprise applies for it because of the collaboration. And this is also producing a lot of interdisciplinary projects. Yeah, again, I should have taken that to the incentive system part, but it's also related to transfer, of course. So that's an interesting incentive system. Okay, so far so good. So that's the framework. And now my last remarks go to the organization of research and the organization of teaching and learning. So still a bit more to the heart of the university. Some examples for research. So what are good conditions for research to stimulate interdisciplinary research? Of course, we have now in our country, we have a lot of topic-oriented PhD schools. So it's quite usual that in a PhD school, people from different disciplines sit together and do their thesis on related topics in different disciplines, on looking, like I said in the beginning, looking at the same thing from different paradigms. Special formats for joint research. I just learned yesterday that the vice rector of this university was born and studied in Bielefeld, so he would know that example. CIF, that's the Central Center for Interdisciplinary Research in Bielefeld, which is a very interesting thing. It exists now, I think, for 30, 40 years or so. It's a nice building somewhere in the woods next to this university, and they make calls to researchers of different disciplines on a specific topic. They select these researchers, and then these researchers can sit together for half a year or so. So they leave their universities, they sit together there, and they only have contact to these guys to work on something. Yeah, with a lot of freedom, a lot of academic freedom to do it, but just putting people together in the same place where they cannot run away. This is not a very attractive city. Yeah, so there is nothing which you could do except sitting together with the colleagues from the other faculties. And so that's a special format. Again, the Technical University in Dresden, they created what they call open topic professorships. So they have a couple of professorships where they say they are not attached to faculties. We just look for outstanding people, but we don't define tasks, we don't define a subject, we just say we are looking for bright people, yeah, people with a great future in whatever discipline, and we just give them all freedom in our university, and that led, recently heard about one example where they hired a professor for music something, and he now works together with people from engineering. I cannot tell you on what. I don't know how music is related to engineering, but engineers, musicians among you might know that better. Yeah, but it seems to work. Yeah, and these guys, they have all freedom to join groups and to work together. So also an interesting thing. You cannot have too many of them. Yeah, but if you have a couple of them, that could be an interesting thing. So organization of research. Example, Freiburg University has the Freiburg Institute of Advanced Studies. So they invite 50 fellows per year for minimum 3 months, internal and external, junior and senior. They are sitting in a very nice own building. They have the freedom to do all kind of research for some time without everyday task. And there are exchange formats to stimulate collaboration. So there are interdisciplinary colloquia, there is tea time. So every day, I think every day at 4 o'clock or so, they meet for tea time, yeah, where they all come together, joint lunches, dinner speeches, retreats. And the important thing is the tea time is not voluntary. You have to take part. So if you join this as a fellow, you have to sign a fellowship agreement, And the fellowship agreement says you have to show up every day for tea time, yeah, and all the other things. So this is also, yeah, but people there, they love it. Yeah, so that's really something where you can get out of your everyday business, meet interesting people, and get new ideas in an interdisciplinary context. So great instrument. They have a funding issue. They don't know if they can continue with that. I just picked a study from 2003, which I found quite interesting. This study identified what interdisciplinary research groups need. So what are the success factors for interdisciplinary research? And I think there are some very interesting things in here. It's inspiring, motivating leadership. That's always important. The proximity, yeah, it's just you have to be close together. Yeah, so then you can collaborate. Joint processes of planning, a kind of corporate identity, trust building. And this one, I like this one, take time to develop a joint language. I know from this institute in Bielefeld that the first weeks, I recently talked to a researcher who was there, and he said, well, the first 2 or 3 weeks, we took them to understand our languages, yeah, our disciplinary languages. If a guy from humanities talks to a lady from engineering, yeah, that's not easy, yeah, because they have different terms and they talk. And so this is really something you need that time to develop a joint language, stakeholder involvement, and you also need conflict resolution mechanisms, but it also might be quite clear. My last point, organization of teaching and learning. So what about this? What can we do here? Study programs, of course, could be organized in a more interdisciplinary way. We have, in our country and in other countries, we are in a phase where study programs differentiate. There are topic-oriented masters, more comprehensive programs, merging disciplines, and so on. We have service learning as an important component. That means community service becomes part of curricula. So we do that in many universities now. So we send students out to the local communities to solve problems there in an interdisciplinary context, and they get credits. So this is not just something they do in their free time. So it's really part of the teaching. So they get ECTS for it and integrate service learning into curricula. Development in many universities, maybe you also do that. When I was studying many, many years ago, I studied business studies and economics. And for the first semester, I was only bothered with statistics and mathematics. And I didn't know what this is good for. Yeah, so this was really heavy burden in the beginning, but I didn't know where I would go in my future and why all this is useful. So what many universities now do in Germany, I think almost all of them, they start studies with a project. Yeah, so students come and they do not get a course on mathematics. They start with a project. They solve a problem. They get the task, I don't know, the water supply in your city breaks down. Now you all have to work on getting it started again or whatever. Yeah, so a real kind of real project. And then students from all faculties work together on it. Yeah, so I show you some examples later on. For example, Leuphana University Lüneburg, they have a week in the beginning where they're just all the students day and night sit together in their first week of studies to run a project in order to understand what these studies are good for, and in order to understand in a very early phase what other disciplines are and why you need them to solve a problem. And if you do that in the first week of your study, you will have learned it if you are a researcher many years after. Yeah, so I think that's a very nice and important thing. College models of teaching and the famous problem-based learning, where you focus your teaching around certain problems which are also interdisciplinary. Examples. Interesting development in Germany from 2005 to 2015, the number of study programs in our country went up from 11,000 to 18,000. Yeah, so within 10 years, 7,000 new study programs. Well, that's an amazing development. And some of them are based on intradisciplinary differentiation. For example, special sectors. So, for instance, I'm a professor for higher education management. Higher education management didn't exist 15 years ago. There was just management. But now we have health management, higher education management, whatever management. So that's within the discipline or subtopics. But there is also interdisciplinary differentiation, topic-oriented study programs. Today in Germany, you can study mobility, yeah, or you can study renewable energies as the name of a study program with interdisciplinary content. There are hybrids, for instance, biocomputer sciences, yeah, where in the program the fields come together, or it's the generalistic approach. You can now study law, economics, and political sciences. So that's the title of a study program. So not studying law, economics, or political sciences, but all the three, and they all are one-third of the curriculum. There is a controversial debate about that. You will find many people who say, does this really make sense? Yeah, if these people are involved in all these three fields, do they understand anything really about law if law only takes one-third of the curriculum? Yeah, you can argue about that, if this is a good development or not. Or there's a discussion, for instance, if someone studies renewable energies, is this already too specialized? Yeah, would it be better if you study physics and later on you deal with renewable energies, maybe in a master? So is it too early to do that already in a bachelor or whatever? Yeah, so you can discuss about it. Two or three examples in the end. University of Twente, they have a bachelor on technology and liberal arts and sciences. So you see a very broad bachelor approach. They want to create something like a new engineer, engineering sciences, social sciences. If you are a student here, in the beginning, you set up your personal development plan. So you don't have a curriculum, you have a personal development plan. Yeah, that makes a difference. That means individualization of curricula. Yeah, you set up your own way through this whole portfolio of interdisciplinary offers. It's very much project-based. There is a week of inspiration as part of the lectures with out-of-the-box lectures and so on. So here are some examples for that. Yeah, so that's a very different approach and very, yeah, very individualized careers of knowledge careers of students. The Jacobs University in Bremen, they have the Jacobs Bachelor in a foundation year. So in a foundation year, you can participate in all undergraduate classes exploring mobility, health, and diversity. And there are subject-related courses on statistics, sciences, business, psychology, environmental sciences, and German politics and culture. And all students have to go through that. Yeah, so they all have to take these classes, and later on, they specialize. Or what I mentioned before, the Leuphana University in Lüneburg. This is the first semester of the Leuphana Bachelor. There is this opening week with the project that I already mentioned. Yeah, and all work together to solve a problem. There are three interdisciplinary modules, and there are two subject-specific modules, and the semester ends with a conference week. Yeah, so also quite interesting new concept. Here you can see what the opening week means. So this is just a short description. You can read it if you can read it from the back. So just giving some ideas what this means. So the opening week is both a practical workshop and a forum for ideas. You will gain a first impression of the way in which scientific work, practical experience, and responsibility are combined. Yeah, and so this year it focuses on the globally interconnected society digital transformation. Yeah, so this is the topic of the week. And all the students work together to do something in that respect. So interesting model. So I confronted you now with a lot of examples in different aspects. I tried to sort it a bit with this model. And here are my conclusions. The topic problem orientation is a main driver of interdisciplinarity. There is a variety of institutional settings to do interdisciplinary research. Communication, rewards, and incentive system have to support strategies. There is a crucial role, if you look at teaching, of the study entry phase, you know, the beginning of studies. This is the place where you can teach people that interdisciplinarity makes sense, for instance, by having such a project. Study programs have to find the balance between disciplinary in-depth knowledge and interdisciplinary knowledge. Faculties without horizontal structures will fail to meet the needs of societies. So without these horizontal connections, I think it will not work. But an academic home base is of course still inevitable, but there, it's no reason to isolate yourself from others. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Frank, for your presentation. Nós temos meia hora agora para perguntas. Talvez a gente possa fazer como os colegas têm feito, a gente abre para três perguntas, pode ser em português ou inglês, eu passo para o Frank e ele dá as respostas em conjunto.
Good morning, Professor. My name is Professor Gladstone, and I would like to ask you to talk about the interdisciplinarity and the universities that has relationship with the productive sector, if it's easier to turn the course interdisciplinary.
Mm. Answer immediately, or?
Só um minuto que ele vai fazer umas anotações para não esquecer das perguntas.
Directly, okay.
Okay, no.
No, okay.
Hello, Professor Frank Ziegler. I want to know about the model. I'm here. About the models that you present here. Do you think that these models could be transferred or adapted to any university? Because we know that universities are very different between them. And a great dimension that you mentioned in your show is that the university have to make good connections with government, society, and industry. So I want to hear about your opinion. Thank you.
Good morning, Professor Ziegler. I wonder how easy it is to publish in journals considering interdisciplinary research. What we have in Brazil, as far as I can see, we have more incentive to publish in disciplinary journals, where there's not so many incentive to publish in interdisciplinary journals, or we can even add that to transdisciplinary approach, which is something even beyond, which is probably more difficult to have publications or journals for that. Thank you.
Okay, so first round of answers. Maybe starting with the last one, that's a very important issue. So in my presentation, what I did, I tried to focus on the things that a university itself can do in order to promote interdisciplinarity. Yeah? But of course, there are other things not only the internal structures or the incentive systems or whatever, but there are other things which are severe obstacles to interdisciplinarity. And I would mention two of them. So one is what you said, the structure of journals, yeah, which of course reward peer-reviewed journals are often in a very narrow disciplinary context. Yeah, and coming back to my topic of yesterday, if you want to move up the rankings and publish in a peer-reviewed journal, quite often you are forced into a very narrow disciplinary context. So this is an important obstacle, which I don't know how it could be overcome. I think it's something that has to do with publishers and the whole development of open sources and open online sources, etc. So that's a very big topic. I don't know if this is the same here in your country, in Germany at the moment. We are struggling with the publishers. Yeah, so there are a lot of fights with Elsevier and all these people who control these markets, and this is a very difficult thing. I would mention a second one in funding of research by national research councils. Yeah, we have in Germany, we also have, it's called DFG, so the German Research Council. And in these funding structures, it's also sometimes very difficult for interdisciplinary research. I recently talked to a professor who works in medicine technology. And all the time he hands in a proposal for research, the people from medicine say, this is not medicine. And the people from engineering say, this is not engineering. Yeah, so, and there is no sensitivity for the combination. And that is related to the peer structures behind these research council funding systems. Yeah, so I think I cannot offer you immediate solutions to these two things, but we can mark it as important obstacles to become more interdisciplinary. The question if what I presented can be adapted to any university in any kind of country, no, of course not. So I have a very clear position towards international experiences. I'm deeply convinced that every country and every university has to find their own ways which fit with the culture, with the political circumstances and everything. But at the same time, I'm deeply convinced that you should not reinvent the wheel, but look around in the world what's happening. And then you can make a decision. If you look at all the things I presented today, maybe you said, my matrix structure in the Netherlands, you would say, this is so crazy. I could never imagine that this works in Brazil. But maybe there is another thing where you think, this makes sense. Yes, so always analyze, but take into account the experiences. Yeah, because we are all in the whole world, we are doing similar things in higher education. So be open to that, learn, but find your own way. So that's always what I try to say about how to deal. A very general answer, but how to deal with international differences. And for instance, it plays a crucial role if a system is very much state controlled or very autonomous in terms of universities. Yeah, some of the things I presented you today in terms of organization wouldn't have been possible in Germany 10 years ago, because if you look into our legislation 10 years ago, the legislation would say universities are organized in faculties, full stop. Yeah, so there was no chance to have these cross-cutting things. But in our country, legislation changed, and now there is something we call organizational autonomy. So the internal organization is, in most of our states, completely up to the university. So they can say, if they want, they can say, let's get rid of faculties. We don't need them anymore. Yeah, which was not my argument today. Yeah, so it always depends on the context. If it's easier if you're close to the productive sector, well, in some respect, maybe yes, because, well, this close relationship to external stakeholders provokes you to think about problems that can only be solved in an interdisciplinary way. So the danger to sit only in your own context and not looking left and right, if you are in close contact with the outside world and work with industry and so on, somehow you are forced to do this and to become more interdisciplinary. Yeah, but not saying that a university which is not so practical oriented cannot also do that. Yeah, so the Leuphana University I just presented with these new teaching approaches, they are not very close to industry, but they still have this new concept to bring together disciplines. So I think everyone can do it, but the stakeholder relationship sometimes helps. You saw that also in the success factors for interdisciplinary research. There was one saying, if you are close to stakeholders, it's easier. Okay, so far so good.
Good morning, Professor. Thank you for your talk. I have two topics I want to develop, if you can. How dynamic could be the research centers as themes and problems changes? If they are created as the organizational structure of the university, I think they tend to behave as academic units in the sense they formalize research on master and doctoral programs. So they should undergo evaluation in the same criteria of disciplinary programs, and I think it's a big problem. So how do you think we could avoid that? Mm-hmm. And the other question is, in terms of undergraduate curricula, we have a recent experiences in Brazil, and it was also the original project of University of Brasília that bachelors in big areas, say for example humanities or life sciences, differentiating after the second or third year in specific careers. What do you think it's a good model for interdisciplinarity on undergraduation?
Mais alguma pergunta? Okay.
Morning, Professor. I wonder if when you were talking with these people, you realized the triggering thought of interdisciplinarity in these institutions. You show the thing like a sort of a trend. There is a movement to interdisciplinarity. What's the triggering thought if you ever came across something like that? Please.
Mais alguma questão?
Good morning, Professor. My name is Natalia, and I would like you to know a little bit more about the process of the implementation of this infrastructure, because, as you told, the communication between the areas, it's very important. So how it's possible for them to approach and construct this interdisciplinary program?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, so first point, well, to say it in one sentence, if you created such a research center, then you do not get rid of it anymore. And it develops somehow, in the end, it develops like a faculty and goes into the same direction. Very important problem. I from time to time, I also work as a consultant for universities. And recently, I had a project where a rector called me and said, oh, we created all these units. They are not needed anymore because the problems changed. And now we do not get rid of them anymore. So these guys are still sitting there. They are still telling me, oh, this is the most important problem. But all the others think it's not important anymore. And so I think that's a matter of Well, what are the terms and conditions of establishing such units? Yeah, because the problem of that university was when they founded it, there was the message, it's founded for eternity. Yeah, and so we in that university, we changed the model into a very clear model, which says you are established for 5 years. Yeah, it could be continued, but we use, that's an instrument I already mentioned yesterday, we use the instrument of performance agreements. So we sign a performance agreement between the rectorate, so the university as a whole, and this this organizational unit, defining the goals and everything. And if after 5 years we have the idea you reach the goals, there are still goals ahead and so on. So there's a discussion after 5 years where there is the option to close it down. Usually it will not be closed down immediately because you need a certain time to let things develop. But I think that would be the way to steer it. And you really have a problem if you started by saying, okay, here is the issue of solving water problems and this is what we will do for eternity. I think that would be the wrong way. The question, if I think that a bachelor in humanity is a good idea, difficult. This is just anecdotal evidence, so I don't really have research about it, saying this is the right or this is the wrong way. I would say if a bachelor is too broad, then I would see a problem that people are not secure anymore in specific methodology. Yeah, I would, for instance, what I just had on my slides, this bachelor on political sciences, law, and economics. Yeah, if you have these three disciplines with very different paradigms, yeah, very, very different paradigms, and you say each of these disciplines counts for 1/3 of the bachelor, what do you really have in the end? Are you a complete economist? Are you a complete lawyer? Are you a complete political scientist? I would say no. So I personally think a too broad approach could be problematic. Maybe that's different in life sciences. I don't know. I'm not an expert for every field. Yeah, I'm an economist. So I talked about that one, and I think that doesn't work. But we have to see. The triggering thought for interdisciplinarity is, I think, we have to solve a problem. Very, very short. I think that's the most convincing thing. If everyone realizes we have to solve a problem, and if we don't use the other discipline as well, we will not solve it. In that moment, you got the idea. And the communication, yes. Yeah, so of course this is difficult. I tried. So this was more focused on teaching and learning, on programs, or in general. In general, yeah. Yeah. So I said you just have to. Maybe that's something to relate it to what you said before. This is something you have to relate to the culture of your country and your university. Yeah, because communication is something that is very much related to a cultural context. So the colleagues in China, they communicate with each other in a different way than Europeans. Or I know that our Dutch neighbors have a much tougher communication style than Germans. Yeah, and Germans always talk about problems, and other countries always talk about opportunities or whatever. Yeah. So I think the way in which you bring people together to communicate has to adapt to this cultural context. And I showed you a range of things, the scouts that I mentioned, yeah, who are organizing retreats with people. Yeah. So the question is, in what kind of surrounding do you need to do something like that? Yeah. In our country, I don't know if it's the same, if you are somewhere where people can run away, they always run away. and so you have to be in a place, like I said before, where you cannot run away. So do not do this retreat in the university but take them somewhere in a nice area, in the rainforest or wherever. Yeah. So you need stimulating environments that are close to the cultural setting. And I think in that way, we have to think about how to organize communication.
Mais alguma pergunta? Em cima.
Good morning. My question is a very basic one. I hope you will forgive me. Do you see a very big difference between transdisciplinarity and interdisciplinarity? Or this difference could be related to the different models you showed?
I may have another question. I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Alfredo Feres Neto. I'm a professor at the Faculty of Physical Education here. I really wanted to do this question. Thank you. And if I may add something else related to what you said as obstacles, do you feel an obstacle would be the supposed resistance that we researchers we have toward open up a dialogue? Because once we interact in an interdisciplinary approach, we get into that. We have to be open to listen. We have to sort of put aside some of our beliefs, or to be open to collaborate. So this could be, would this be an obstacle? Would this relate to some sort of vanity that we might have that could be an obstacle to that? Thank you.
Mais uma pergunta última? No? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the first one, as I said in the beginning, I'm a very practical guy. Yes, yeah, so when I prepared the thing and then I dig deeper into these issues, and I thought, oh, this is a bit boring, this discussion about trends or inter or whatever. So but what I think is, I think this is one of the aspects of distinction between these different modes of relating disciplines. There is one mode which is more doing things in parallel but not really relating. Yeah, and what I have in mind, and I think this is what usually is called transdisciplinarity, what I have in mind, I tried to say it in the beginning with this one slide, is something where happens what you said, where really you put aside your beliefs and you deal with the other paradigm and you bring things together and you create joint products. It's not only about having the one article in the one disciplinary journal and the other article in the other disciplinary journal, and they are somehow a bit related, but it's really about producing something jointly. And I think that would be the distinction between these two things. And what I hope that most of the things that I mentioned would contribute to really do things together and not in parallel, but really together. Yeah, and if you do that, so the two things are related, all what you mentioned has to happen. And I think, well, it's challenging, yeah, because we all know that we have our identity as we have our beliefs, how the world is going around from the perspective of an economist, yeah, but if we not manage to listen to others or to put aside our beliefs, or to open up, there will be no progress. Yes, yeah, so there is this obstacle, but I don't know what we can, like I said before, this aspect of teaching and learning, that in the very first week when students see a university for the first time, yeah, in our country we have many students, the so-called first generation students, I think you also have them, where who have no academics in their family, and they see such an institution for the first time, and they come to the university, and if at that moment they are put into an interdisciplinary project, what kind of start in your academic life would that be? And so I think this is something that makes an important contribution, that the researchers of tomorrow are able to overcome their small beliefs and are able to listen to others. So if we don't do it with students, we will not have it in the end with experienced researchers. So you and I, we might still have the problem, but we hope that the younger people sitting here who might have different experiences might do it differently in the future. So that's my hope. Yeah.
I just want to give some closing words. I want to thank again Dr. Ziegele for this wonderful opportunity for us to discuss issues that certainly bother us, as was made explicit with the last intervention. Of course, it's kind of shaking the paradigms of what we believe science is, what we believe our field is. The vanity aspect, of course, must be overcome for this to happen. And maybe the only way out is this: trust the future academics, right? Trust the future researchers who must have this experience from the beginning, so that they see the importance of talking with the neighbor next door in the next department and making sure. We even have separations of departments within institutes that wouldn't make much sense in the opinion of most of us. I come from an institute like that, which does not make sense to me the way some departments are separated from the others. So if it is a challenge within the same area, let alone the whole university, we would have to break too many paradigms to make that work, but I don't think that should prevent us from trying, at least. So thank you very much, Dr. Ziegele. Thank you all for being here. We'll continue in 5 minutes.